Good morning. Welcome to this morning's worship service, and a very special welcome if you happen to be a visitor with us today. And if you're a first-time visitor, we'd be delighted if we could welcome you a little more formally, if you'd be willing to stand up and introduce yourself. We don't require that. It's more of a request. But do we have any first-time visitors with us this morning? Those of you sitting in the pews closest to the burgundy worship folders, I invite you at this time to go ahead and take those out and begin to put your information in there. And a reminder, if you have a prayer need, go ahead and fill out one of those prayer request slips. Hang on to it. As you leave worship this morning by the front doors, there's the box on a pedestal that has praying hands on it. You can put your prayer requests in there. They'll be gathered by our prayer ministers, prayed over throughout the week. If you would like some private prayer time with one of our prayer ministers, then gather here at the altar rail closest to the pulpit at the conclusion of today's worship service, and someone will greet you there and have a prayer with you. Known to have been hospitalized, we want to keep in our prayers Art Harker, Dorothy Page, Carol Markle, and Tom Lampkin. We want to extend our Christian sympathies to Judy York on the death of her son, to Melody Schwiffer, and Chuck and Linda White on the death of Melody and Linda's father, Donald Lapsley. So we keep all those folks in our prayers. Just a very brief update on our daughter Jacqueline. We are so grateful. We are seeing your prayers, our prayers, being answered in sometimes miraculous ways. She's really starting to make some serious progress. I don't know if she can write, but I know she can text. So. Apparently writing is a bit more of a challenge than texting, though I don't know how understandable her texts are, but they weren't that understandable before the stroke. So, but she's being able to read and to comprehend some things pretty well, putting sentence structure together. She's unfortunately getting back some of her sense of humor, which was also questionable, but we're so grateful for your prayers. And she was able to Skype with her children this past week, so it's great. Keep praying. Thank you so much, though. God bless you for all of that. God's healing touch is very evident in her life. Let's see, on the bottom of page 2, just volunteer signups for, yes, it's that time of year again, Walk Through Bethlehem. They'll be available today following our worship services, so keep that in mind. On page 11 at the back, I just want to briefly touch those of you who, American Lutheran School, if you ordered the flower bulbs or whatever it looks like, they're going to be available there in today. Just coming up, Young at Heart is Tuesday, October 23rd. They're going to have Ann Somerville, author of the historical novel Parallel Passages, will be there. That should be very interesting, but they are asking you RSVP to the church office. For those of you interested in the communion assistant usher training, there's information about that in your bulletin. That's next Sunday. Again, they need you to RSVP for that. Altar flowers today given by Steve Kent in honor of his wife Sherry Alimi's birthday. A parish life staff in honor of our newest team member, our Director of Administration, Jill Spassaro. David.
Good.
Yeah, she is good.
She's good. Good morning.
Good morning.
Are you awake? Good morning.
Good morning.
There we go. Next Sunday, we have an incredible event. As you have seen, we have our new hymnals in the pews. We are going to do a hymn dedication next Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock at the Big Sing. We're going to sing through a number of old favorites and a bunch of new stuff that we may not be familiar with. Things that even the choir members, some of the choir members said they had not sung before. It's going to be a wonderful event, but we encourage you to come early because the Scouts will be having a chili feed between noon and 3 o'clock. So come hungry, watch some football, and stay for some hymn singing.
So football during the chili feed.
Football during the chili feed.
Sweet.
Vikings game, I'm sure.
Well, we'll see.
We'll see. Yeah.
With that, we have a special message today. I'm going to invite Rachel Sarti. to come up if she would. And she's going to be at our lectern. And Rachel is one of our MOPS, Mother of Preschool Leaders. She was a MOPS participant prior to that. She's going to share with us a little bit about that incredible ministry that is only possible because of your faithful and generous support of that ministry. Rachel.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Rachel, as Pastor Jack said, and I'm the coordinator of MOPS. MOPS stands for Mothers of Preschoolers. However, we reach out to moms with children ages birth through kindergarten. We are a ministry here at American Lutheran, and we're also part of an international organization called MOPS International. And it's a Christian nonprofit organization for women and mothers with over 4,000 groups worldwide. I came to MOPS just a few days after moving to Prescott. It was the registration play date, so I showed up with my one-year-old twins at the Granite Creek Park, not knowing what to expect. I was a little nervous, but everyone was so warm and welcoming. It just felt genuine and like I was in the right place. At the time, I was expecting my third son, so many of the conversations centered around, oh, when are you due? I'd say, January. Oh, when's the baby due? January. Oh. Now, it turns out they were not trying to be rude. I was a little thrown off, but here at American Lutheran, there's this thing called Walk Through Bethlehem. It's kind of a big deal. I don't know if you've heard about it. But really, they were just hoping for a new baby Jesus for that year. And the baby wasn't going to be here in time. MOPS is truly a blessing to the 119 registered mamas. Our group has experienced unprecedented growth in the last 2 years or so, and it really proves to us that we are serving where there is a need. My MOPS Prescott, as we call it, ministers to women from all walks of life, working moms, at-home moms, average churchgoers, and moms who are just getting their toes wet. We provide education, testimony, and opportunities for service and a safe place for mamas during this season of our lives. MOPS brings women and families closer to God. MOPS International shared with us that through the MOPS ministry, over 10,000 women committed their lives to Jesus Christ last year alone. The president of MOPS, Mandy Arioto, shared a story with us about a man growing up. He called the MOPS headquarters and said, Mandy, do you know my mom? She was in MOPS over 30 years ago. And Mandy said, I'm sorry, I don't, but I can look her up. He said, MOPS literally saved our lives. This was the first place where we could go where I learned to trust a man who was a MOPS childcare worker. He said, this was the first place where someone told me that God loves me. So we can just see the far reach and the impact that MOPS has on people's lives. This man just wanted to thank MOPS for being the saving grace for his family, and Mandy reminded us all that we are just doing important work. Years from now, someone may call up with a story of how one of us had impacted their lives. I'm grateful to MOPS for so many reasons, including bringing my family to American Lutheran Church. We're members here now. We have a place to worship and raise our children. And when I first came to MOPS, I came to get my cup filled, deep in the trenches of motherhood. But now I am so blessed to be in a place where I have grown and learned through this ministry that I'm here along with our 30-person leadership team serving the women who need their cups filled. Our group routinely shares things that we are grateful for. One mom recently shared, I am beyond grateful that at 33 years old, I finally have real, true, warm-hearted, loving friends, my besties, my moms. One of our treasured mentor moms said, I love the experiences I am blessed to have through MOPS. This ministry is thriving and making a big impact on women and their families. We simply could not do it without the resources provided to us from American Lutheran. We're blessed by our advisors through Children's Ministry, Kathy and Tricia. We have a beautiful place to fellowship. And let me tell you, eating a hot breakfast that we didn't have to cook or clean up after is truly a blessing. The amazing volunteers who hold our babies during the meetings while we get time to be ourselves, be with our people, and drink a hot cup of coffee. We remind each other, you've got this, Mama. And Jesus has us all. Thank you to everyone here at American Lutheran who believe in us and support this ministry, because we firmly believe better moms, better world. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. And at this time, I invite everyone to stand as they are able. We'll quiet our minds, center our hearts, prepare to come into the worship of our Lord.
We worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, the one who fashions us, the one who heals us, the one who reforms us again and again.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, calling for God's transforming power. Source of all life, we confess that we have not allowed your grace to set us free. We fear that we are not good enough. We hear your word of love freely given to us, yet we expect others to earn it. We turn the church inward rather than moving it outward. Forgive us, stir us, reform us to be a church powered by love, willing to speak for what is right, act for what is just, and seek the healing of your whole creation. Amen. God hears our cry and sends the Spirit to change us and to empower our lives in the world. Our sins are forgiven, God's love is unconditional, and we are raised up as God's people who will always be made new. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Let us pray together. Sovereign God, you turn your greatness into goodness for all the peoples on earth. Shape us into willing servants of your kingdom and make us desire always and only your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The reading is from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 10th chapter. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put Jesus to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" And he answered Jesus, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. And he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Now, which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? And he said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Before I begin today's sermon message, I again want to briefly encourage you in regard to, I know that we have Dedication Sunday coming up next week. You've been receiving stewardship materials in the mail. I hope you've actually taken the time to read carefully through them. And you've received notice that things are changing a little bit. And this really is in regard to those people who have so faithfully and generously supported our ministry through their gifts to our building program. And you probably noticed in the letter addressed this, that the way we're doing our accounting and purchasing moving forward is that the building program, or the building fund, which was designed initially to pay off the mortgage to this building, which by the grace of God has been paid off now for almost 5 years, those expenses that have been typically coming out of the building fund are all being shifted to the general fund, which means that we absolutely, desperately need you, if you have given to the building fund in the past, to switch your giving over to the general fund, because if you don't, then we're going to have some problems, we're going to have some issues. I don't think this is going to be a big deal, but there are some folks that are a little bit nervous because, again, it is a change. So I'm just asking you to please prayerfully consider whatever you've given in the past to the building fund, that you faithfully now assign those to the general fund for the coming year. Enough said about that. The world has certainly changed a lot since September 11th, 2001. And certainly our American way of life has changed a lot since 9/11. I and most of you, or many of you, are reminded of that anytime you go through one of those lovely TSA checkpoints at the airport. And I was reading in the paper the other day, I don't want to blow your minds away or anything, but within a couple years, your Arizona driver's license isn't going to get you on a plane either. If this is the first I've told you of that, do some research. In a couple years, it seems we're going to need to have a passport or one of these new fandangled special driver's licenses, and I look to see, what do you have to do to get one of those? And you've got to produce a birth certificate and your social security card and your firstborn child's fingerprints. I don't know. So anyway, I just got done sending away to my home state, Montana, to get a copy of my birth certificate and North Dakota birth certificate from for Luann. And because I want to be able to get on an airplane, and I don't necessarily want to get a passport, so I keep that in mind. But I mean, that's the kinds of things that we've experienced since 9/11, right? What really gets to me since 9/11 is this. I'm reminded of the way our country has changed. Whenever I'm in Fry's or someplace else and I cross the path of a firefighter or a police officer, or maybe in the airport you come across a young man or woman in military uniform, And the result usually is a smile and a nod, and maybe just a few short words of affirmation like, thank you. Thank you for your service. And I hear that. I hear that in the grocery store. I hear it downtown in Prescott. I hear it all over the place. I mean, prior to 9/11, I don't remember people buying meals for strangers in restaurants, simply because that person, the one receiving that meal, happened to be wearing either a uniform or maybe a cap that reflected their status as a veteran. But I've witnessed it many times in the last few years. Most of us, I think, now have a deeper sense of appreciation for those who put their life on the line, day in and day out, to protect us and to keep some sense of order in this crazy, mixed-up world we live in. That's a positive change since 9/11. The fact of the matter is that I have never, believe it or not, I have never pulled a child out of a burning building. I have never confronted a dangerous criminal. I've been confronted by dangerous criminals. I was robbed at gunpoint once, but I've never performed CPR on a heart attack victim. I've never risked my life or a limb protecting our nation from a foreign enemy. And statistically speaking, neither have most of you. Currently, only 0.5% of our nation's citizens are serving in the military. 0.5%. Less than 7% of our current population has ever served in the military. And that number is shrinking as we lose more and more veterans from World War II and Korea and Vietnam. It's only because of the resurgence of military activity in Iraq, in Syria, and Afghanistan that those numbers haven't dropped even further. And much smaller numbers than that comprise those we identify as first responders, policemen, firemen, paramedics. My point is this: it seems that heroes are becoming harder and harder to come by. Or are they? Now, in no way do I wish to diminish the service or the sacrifice of our first responders, our current service members, or our veterans. But the truth of the matter is, heroism remains a vital part of the heartbeat of America. It's just that so many of our modern day heroes are flying under the radar. They're unsung, they're unrecognized. In many cases, they're unappreciated for all that they do to make our world a much, much better place, especially for the most vulnerable of our citizens, those who are living on the brink. Most of us do not see ourselves as a hero. My guess, however, is that most of us do more life-saving than we ever realize. Educators do it. Teachers do it. Every day. Changing lives and saving lives. Sunday school teachers do it. Professional counselors do it. Parents do it. Coaches do it. Good friends do it. Because you see, anytime we exert an effort that enhances life rather than diminishes it, anytime we are part of that, we have potentially become a life saver. How many frightened, abused children have almost given up hope until meeting that one teacher who cared enough to make them feel loved or safe or worthy? How many lonely adults have been at the end of their rope, wondering if life is even worth the trouble anymore, but then someone came along to take a little time to love them or to phone them or drop by and see them, to listen to them, and in so doing, remind them that they're not alone. It may well be that in those moments I just spoke of, somebody's life was saved. Saved from agony, saved from depression, saved from despair, and yes, sometimes even from death itself. How many persons have walked back from the ledge of suicide or drug addiction or hunger or loneliness or hopelessness or despair because someone, maybe it was a professional, but maybe it was someone like you and me, took the time, made the effort to listen, to provide some loving advice, counsel, support. And I know I've shared with you my own story, and I won't get into it again, but how a complete stranger, somebody I don't know what his name is, I can barely picture his face anymore, who took the time with me 30-some years ago now to introduce me to the very first time, to my first AA meeting. And I guarantee you, that man saved my life. He saved my life. I don't know his name. I don't imagine he thinks of himself as a hero. Jesus taught that in the process of saving the lives of others, that is how we find our own life. You want to know what the meaning of life is, the purpose of life? A life with meaning, dignity, and purpose. Jesus says, whoever would save his life would lose it, but whoever would lose his life for my sake and others, the same shall find it. And he's not talking about sacrifice on a battlefield here. He could be, but what he's talking about, people who would give of their own life, their own time, their own talent, their own financial resource, whatever it is, to save the life of another person, to enhance the life of another person. Jesus says that's the person who will find life. A follower of Jesus, a man named Luke, he was getting at something like that when he told the story of this scribe, this lawyer who asked Jesus about finding life. Now, the translations interpret the scribe's question to be, what must I do to inherit eternal life? But Jesus' response in the long run really helps us to understand that Jesus is moving beyond this whole thing of eternal life. And what Jesus is really trying to do is approach this question from a different angle. And the way that Jesus responds is, it helps us to understand that what Jesus really thinks is important here is it has less to do with eternal life and has much more to do with a life well lived right in the here and now. Because according to Jesus, the real question that needs to be addressed is, what must I do to really be alive now? Not just, you know, function or breathe air or take up space on this planet, but what must I do to count for something in the eyes, the heart, the mind of God in the here and now? And Jesus answered the question ultimately by telling the parable of the Good Samaritan. A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell among thieves. And in this story, Jesus tells, the traveler is stripped, robbed, beaten, and left for dead, you know, pretty much in a ditch on the side of the road. Now it so happened as time passed by that a priest and later a Levite walked by, saw the traveler there, but passed by on the other side. They didn't want to get involved, or they didn't feel a need to get involved, or he's not from my tribe, you know, or whatever. But at last there came that way a Samaritan. And when he saw him, this is the key, he had compassion. He had compassion for a complete stranger. Somebody he never met before, somebody he didn't know. He went to him, he bound up his wounds, he put him on a horse, he took him to an inn, He took care of him. Then he gave money to the innkeeper, charged that the man should be tended to, and if any additional funds were needed, that it should be charged to his account, and he would make it right later. Then Jesus looked at this lawyer, this scribe who had asked that question, the one about finding life, and Jesus said to him, "Go, do likewise." In plain words, what he was saying is, well, I just told you the story of this Good Samaritan, this man who had compassion for complete strangers, people he didn't know, and I want you to go and be like that person. I want you to find your life by giving your life away. For whoever, whenever you do anything, and I'm talking to you, whenever you do anything to save or strengthen the life of another human being, in that very moment, that is how you will find meaning and purpose for your own life. Now, it may come as a shock to you that I believe that the parable of the Good Samaritan is a stewardship message. Oh, yes, it is. If it wasn't, it is now. Because you see, to be a good steward, manager of one's time, talent, and financial resources compels a disciple, a follower of Jesus, to become involved in the ministry of life-saving. That's really what it's all about. My point is this, that one of the key ways in which we do what the Good Samaritan did, because that's what Jesus said, go and do likewise, is through our congregation's ministries. And specifically through our charitable donations of time and talent and financial resources in those ministries so that we can accomplish God's will and purpose in this world. Admittedly, I know now I'm probably skating on thin ice. I threw you a little curveball here. Because I realize that any mention of financial stewardship triggers for some a certain level of discomfort, right? Some, not most, but some people liken stewardship and stewardship programs and stewardship messages as an endorsement of spiritual blackmail, right? And none of us is entirely comfortable with financial blackmail, whether it's spiritual or otherwise. Now, I'm looking out at this group, and I'm going to say confidently that I believe that most of you are probably huge, huge fans of the rock group AC/DC. How many of you have AC/DC's greatest hits? It doesn't exist. You are an AC/DC fan. They don't have a greatest hits album. You gotta get on iTunes and pull all your favorites. And you, Dr. Dan Beck, would probably know, being the AC/DC fan you are, that they have a song called Money Talks. And it's a good one. And these are some of the lyrics to Money Talks. It says, "Come on, come on, love me for the money. Come on, come on, listen to the money talk." Listen to the money talk. You say, money talks? Oh, you better believe money talks. Money has a lot to say. It has a lot to say about the world we live in. It has a lot to say about how we perceive that world. But it does more than just talk, because in the right hands, used the right way, money saves lives. And it restores hope. And it heals hurts. And it builds futures. And when used by God, money can and does save souls for all eternity. And that's why Proverbs 3:9 says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth." Last week, we were blessed to have Pastor Rick and Pastor Robin with us from Amazing Grace Church. They shared the sermon message. They spoke powerfully of how the benevolence dollars that you graciously share with our congregation out of your gratitude for God's blessings, how those benevolence dollars you share with us, our congregation in turn sends a portion of those benevolence dollars to Amazing Grace. And Amazing Grace is doing remarkable things for the glory of God in their prison and jail ministry. Now, most of you probably don't want to go hang out in the jail any longer than you have to, or in the prison any longer than you have to. But isn't it amazing that there are people who are willing to do that and to witness to Jesus Christ to the captives in prison? Amazing Grace does that. You're part of that ministry. You're saving souls in jail through your contributions to our congregation's ministry that we share with them. Through our financial support of Amazing Grace and others, lives are being saved. They shared that with us. Souls are being captured for God because you support our ministry, and our congregation in turn supports their ministry. How is your generous support of our congregation changing lives for the glory of God? Really, that's the whole emphasis of our stewardship program this year. By clothing impoverished teens in our community, many of whom are hopeless or living in foster care, allowing them to integrate with their peers without being exposed to the stigma of poverty. And that ministry, which many of you know and love and support faithfully, is called Teens Closet. We just had our Spaghetti Dressetti fundraiser for that. Each Sunday in our downstairs fellowship hall, our neighbors gather, and I use that word on purpose, neighbors, because remember the man asked, who is my neighbor? Right? They are our neighbors, and they gather downstairs in our fellowship hall. And down there each Sunday, they receive a free meal. And they are nourished not only with a hearty, nutritious meal, but they are also nourished with the love, the respect, and the inspirational word of God, which is food for the soul. Your generous financial gifts make it possible, as Rachel shared with us earlier, for young, struggling mothers to have a chance to gather, have a great meal, receive support from their peers, hear words of advice and encouragement, get a brief break. It's a brief break from their unending parental responsibilities so that they can enjoy some life, lighthearted and life-affirming fellowship. That program, MOPS, is supporting 120 mothers of preschoolers in our community. And I want you to know, it couldn't happen without your support. On Thursday evenings, right here at American Lutheran, recovering drug addicts and alcoholics, and those suffering from other addictive and destructive behaviors, as well as the victims of sexual abuse, anxiety, depression, and a host of other hurts, habits, and hang-ups, they will find strength for this day and hope for tomorrow. They will find a lifeline for recovery and healing right here in our fellowship hall every Thursday. That ministry is called Celebrate Recovery. It's near and dear to my heart, obviously. Celebrate Recovery is saving lives, lives like mine. It's saving souls, souls like mine. It's making the world we live in a better place for the glory of God. And it's only possible because of your generosity. The list goes on and on. We have vibrant ministries to seniors, to youth, to folks that we have never met who are the recipients of life-saving medical and emergency care in a far-off place in West Africa called Guinea, at a place called the Hope Clinic. Appropriately so. And the Hope Clinic is a major receiver of benevolence dollars from our congregation. Now, most of you would never go off to the Hope Clinic in Guinea, West Africa. You'd have no desire to be in the Ebola hot zone. I don't either. But I know that my dollars that I give to this church go to support that ministry. We provide vital assistance in our community to the victims of domestic violence, homelessness, hunger, and despair, to the tune of about $150,000 a year because of your generosity. The most sacred title by which Jesus is known is the title of Savior. one who gave himself to save others. In our modern times, we don't talk about saviors. We talk about heroes. And in the simple act of being faithful, generous stewards of God's blessings, you become a lifesaver and you become a hero. Because you inspire, you transform, you save lives, you save souls for the glory of God. Of course, stewardship involves far more than finances. We know that. What we do with our time and our talent is of paramount concern to God. MOPS is one of those key examples. Rachel mentioned all those, and if you are one of these people, one of these angels from God, who holds those babies and rocks those babies and strolls those babies around our campus or watches all those toddlers downstairs so that those moms can get a brief respite. I mean, it is bedlam around here every other Thursday. I know because the nursery is right across from my office. And I know many of you, I'm looking out at you, the people who come here Thursday after Thursday, I don't want to hold a screaming baby for 10 seconds. And they nurture them for an hour, 2 hours. You're angels. Too often, though, when we talk about financial stewardship, it's mentioned with embarrassment or apologetically, as if the topic of money somehow should be avoided like the plague. I will never apologize for asking you to be faithful stewards of your financial resources. In truth, what we allow the church to do with our financial gifts, it has the real potential to save lives, to enhance lives, and to save souls. According to Jesus, only by embarking on a journey to save the lives of others will we ever truly find life. Life that is worthy of the one who creates and sustains all things. By the way, I'm just going to pick on Dr. Beck over there. He's been known to travel to third world countries and do free anesthesia on people who are having all kinds of surgical procedures. Just one example. I mean, he's sitting there. I might as well give him some kudos. I think Jesus appreciates it. He didn't ask for it. It's enough to make me forgive him for being a Green Bay Packer fan. The scribe asked, "Teacher, what must I do to find life?" And Jesus answered, "A man fell among thieves, who stripped him and beat him and left him for dead on the side of the road. At last there came that way a Samaritan, a hero. And when he saw him, he had compassion. And he went to him, and he bound up his wounds, and he paid for his care with his own money. And Jesus said, 'You go and do likewise.'" The bottom line is, folks, the world desperately needs people who care. People who desire to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. And the Samaritan in today's story, people who understand that the way we commit to using our God-given talent and time and financial resources, it does more, much, much more than keep the lights on and the paper towels in the bathroom. And don't get me wrong, I like lights and I like paper towels. And it does more than provide paychecks for the staff. And I really like a paycheck. But the generous stewardship of our gifts of time, talent, and financial resources is directly connected to our being willing to take up the cross of discipleship, to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, to be a lifesaver, to be a hero for the sake of God and for the glory of God. So as you this week will prayerfully be considering your financial support of our congregation. Many of you will be filling out a pledge card. Others will be thinking about what you will be able to do to support our mission and ministry in the coming year. I want you to please keep this in mind as you do that. Prayerfully do that. That the pathway to abundant life is a journey on the road of compassion and generosity. So I thank you, Jesus, for being our Savior. Help us, Jesus, to be a lifesaver too. Thank you, all of you, who accept the mantle of discipleship. who are willing to use your gifts of time and talent and financial resources to be a life saver, to be a hero for the glory of God, for the building of his kingdom. Amen. And now may the grace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep our hearts and our minds one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. At this time, I would invite you to go ahead and stand as you are able. We'll sing our hymn of the day, number 431.
Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Longing for God's will to be fulfilled among us, we pray persistently for the church, the world, and all people in need. Life-giving Savior, open our hearts and minds to the realization that you are asking us for a sacrifice of praise and a generous spirit to joyfully and willingly use our resources for eternal matters. You have invited us to follow you and to be your heart, hands, and feet to all our neighbors. You have commanded us to share our food with the hungry, to provide shelter and clothing for the poor, giving you the glory for all our good deeds. Guide us to serve others in your name, for we want to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you now and forever. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we ask for your healing touch to be on Art Harker, Tom Lamkin, Carol Markle, and Dorothy Page. As all have been hospitalized, we ask your comfort and peace for Judy York and family on the death of her son Toby, and for Melody Schweffer and Linda and Chuck White on the death of Melody's and Linda's father, Donald Lapsley. We pray for the CDC and all healthcare workers who are on the front lines of defense against deadly viruses throughout the world. We place our trust in you to bring hope and healing to all for whom we silently name in our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy. God of refuge and strength, protect us from the evil and violence that is planted in hearts filled with hate. Give guidance and wisdom to all of our leaders, both within the church and in our government. Arm them with the truth of your mighty word and a sincere desire to do what is right and pleasing in your sight in all matters. Lord, in your mercy. Enfold all things in your compassion, O God, and bring us into your life through the faithfulness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of life, you give us these gifts of the earth, these resources of our life and our labor. Take them, offered in great thanksgiving, and use them to set a table that will heal the whole creation. Through Christ, our Savior and light. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me."
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Speak to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, and make us one with you.